What's up, everybody? Joe Bonamassa here with another exciting episode of Live from Nerdville. Today, my special guest is host of Rock Talk over 20 years, one of my favorite rock journalists, Mitch Lafon. Thank you very much for doing this. You know, every once in a while, I'm really intrigued about interviewing journalists who all they do is interview people like myself for a living. And sometimes I like asking questions to people like you because I'm really intrigued by, you know, how you get into it in the first place. Welcome right to our show.
Well, yes. And as we say in Montreal, because that's my tagline, bonjour. So welcome. Yeah. So you want to know how I got into it? Well, should we go into the story right now?
Well, you know, one of the things is, you know, I've been interviewed a million times. Mm-hmm. And what I've always been intrigued about is, you know, people like yourself, you know, because I always say, like, we all start in our bedroom with a record player, a tape deck, a guitar, some sort of a copy of Rolling Stone magazine or Kerrang. What was the DNA of your musical life? What was the first time you realized that you actually enjoyed music on a much deeper level than just, you know, the radio's on in passing? When was the first time you fell in love?
Well, all right. So, you know, I grew up in a small village of about 600 people. Back in the day in the 70s and 80s, there was nothing. We don't have any businesses in this village. There was nothing going on. So the only thing I had was the record player and the vinyls that were there. And so for many years, it was my mom's vinyls. It was ABBA. It was Beethoven's Fifth. It was all that stuff. And somewhere around 77, 78, my brother borrowed Kiss's Love Gun and Kiss Double Platinum. And he stuck it on right by the record player. And I stared at that image and I went, oh, I can't. Look at them. There's the girls and all. I can't. But eventually I pulled out that vinyl and I saw the dripping blood and I put it on and I heard Shock Me and I heard I Stole Your Love and I heard those Kiss songs and I went, yeah, all right, now we're in. And then I moved over to this double platinum album, which if you know, is this silver shiny album. And of course you fold it out and it's silver and shiny and I'm whatever, 9 years old. And it was just magnificent. And so that's where it started. It was falling in love with those visuals. And I think sometimes we forget that visuals are as much part of the music as the music. And those visuals drew me in and I slapped on those vinyl records and that was it. Everything Kiss was it. And of course that was at the height of Kiss marketing. You know, you had the pinball machines and you had the Love Gun and the lunch boxes. And so you could take that love for those vinyl records and go over, and there was no Walmart back then, at least not here, but it was Kmart and Zellers, and you could go buy that Kiss lunch. And so there was an extension of the music. So it was more than just the music. It became your lifestyle. You had the Kiss lunchbox, you had the Kiss t-shirt, you had the Kiss whatever. And that extension is what, and I thought that every band did that. You know, you looked around and you went, wow, where's the Cheap Trick lunchbox? Where's the Aerosmith lunchbox? And you didn't have it. So that's where it started. It was my brother borrowing those Kiss records. And I just went, wow. All right. And it's the visual. Absolutely the visual that got me into it.
So, you know, one of the things I wanted to ask you is, you know, for me was my father, you know, he would play records every Saturday. And one of the records that really stood out, no pun intended, was the Jethro Tull stand-up record.
Right.
You know, so he puts it on, A New Day Yesterday comes on, and I'm 8 years old, 9 years old, thumbing through this thing. It's a fold-out, and all of a sudden, these characters from, like, a Baroque Shakespearean play pop up. And one of the things I wanted to ask you is, like, you know, we live in a social media world. Hell, we're broadcasting this thing on a social media platform. Do you think that with the accessibility of artists, especially rock and roll, do you think the accessibility kind of kills the mystique? Or is it good to be that available for everyone to kind of give them a glimpse into what you're having for breakfast or your, what your house looks like? Or does the pulling out the blood stained vinyl of a Kiss record, do you think that plants more of a seed and makes your rock and musical heroes larger than life?
I actually think it's both, because I think the fandom in the knots 2000 and above, it has changed. I think if you take my daughter and my kids and you show them a Kiss record with the blood, I don't think that talks to them anymore. What talks to them is going to Instagram and seeing them at the pool and seeing them in Vegas. And that's what attracts a newer fan. So I don't really think we can compare the two, because I think fandom has changed.
Right.
But for me, it was absolutely essential. And that mystique of who's Kiss, what makeup, when are they going to take it off, was essential for me. Right. I don't think that would work for Jada and for Ryan. But, you know, the other thing was, when Kiss came to town, or Aerosmith or whoever, it was an event, because it was once a year. It was once every 2 years. It was once every 3 years. And you didn't know the set list. So you'd go and you'd go, oh, my God. And then they would play an encore and you'd go, oh, we must have been a great crowd. They played an encore.
Right.
And, you know, as we got into social media, you go, oh, it's the same set list as the last 20 towns. And, oh, it's the same encores as the last 20 towns. And so you lose some of that. But you know what? I don't think either one is better, or I think it's just different.
Well, you know, back in the 70s, I mean, to launch a record to radio and to properly promote it took millions of dollars. You were buying print media, which was at a premium at that point. God forbid you had enough for television ads, and you were still in that. They never could. It's, let's call it like it is. It was the payola, you know, era of radio, right, where they were literally trading bags of cocaine for spins on the radio. Now, if you have enough followers, you can just take a photo, point and click, and all of a sudden, the people that are interested in your brand or the kind of music that you play, you know, for free, literally, hey, you go, hey, I have a new record out, you know? Right. I also, my issue with social media is the fact that people then judge everything you do in real time as a referendum on your career. Right. You know, because there was a lot of times back in especially the late 70s, early 80s, where bands would experiment, and now it'd be career ending. What do you think are some of the differences between, like, bands having free reign to experiment and then having these confines of social media and going, I need to just play to the base, really?
Well, that's a good question. You know, one of the things with social media is that, yeah, you get the free advertising and, yeah, you get a million followers, but then you have to keep them engaged. And right, sometimes you follow somebody and they don't post anything for 3 weeks, 4 weeks, a month. And then you're just like, I'm not going to bother checking. So you do have to be continuously creative and have content that is at once not spammy, but at the same time interesting, and it's a very fine line. And in terms of experimenting, you know, there are some bands, you look at AC/DC or Kiss or Aerosmith, and fans don't want them to experiment. They want AC/DC to be AC/DC. And yet other bands have built an entire career on being experimental. Look at Madonna. Look at even Billy Joel. Look at U2. Every album is different, and if they did the same old album, fans would go, hey, no, Madonna, you've already done Holiday, you've already done, like, right, a version, move along. So there's room for both. And you know, listen, I'm a rock fan, so I like my rock to be somewhat stable. Whenever a band like the Scorpions or Kiss, you know, they do Eye to Eye or they do The Elder, fans go, oh my God, what was that? You can't do that. That's not a Kiss record. Don't do that. So, you know, it's damning.
Talk to me about the Scorpions. Now, I'm a huge Scorpions fan. I mean,
thank you.
I know Matthias, and I have a picture of me with Klaus when I was like 13 years old. And I've been a Scorpions fan since I've had a Scorpions record.
Right.
And, you know, Winds of Change was my conduit to the Scorpions. Pre that, I didn't really have any familiarity. Right. But what do you think? There are some bands that come out, put out great music,
mm-hmm,
and have an appeal worldwide. Right. They can sell out They can sell out the arena in Tulsa. They can sell out the arena in Berlin. They can sell out the arena in Montreal. And it just seems to have a universal appeal. Now, a band like the Scorpions, you know, they're a big band here in the United States, but in Europe, that's a stadium event versus maybe a 5 or 6,000 seat event, maybe a little bit more if they're packaged with the right opening band.
Right.
What do you think, you know, and there's some bands like the Stones and there's bands like Bon Jovi, they just kill it all over. What do you think the disparity is, or what do you think the disconnect to sometimes different audiences?
Well, I'll tell you what, because I've had this discussion a lot with artists and I've had a lot with different managers. And I think it really comes down to your management team and how the band was sold to that market. You know, because you look at Status Quo, for example, almost a stadium act in the UK. They come to Florida. They're playing what, a 300 seater? I mean, it's bizarre. And when I've talked to Francis Rossi, when I've talked to these bands, they say, well, you know what? We had a UK manager. They weren't able to do the States. Lawrence Gowan of Styx. I had a long, long, long conversation because he was Gowan in Canada through the 80s, Criminal Mind and all that stuff.
Right.
And I said, Lawrence, why weren't you a big star on MTV? And he said, listen, the record company, and this is the word he used, sandboxed me. They decided that I was going to be a Canadian territory artist and they weren't going to invest outside. So listen, sometimes it comes down to the music. You know, British metal compared to American metal is very different, and sometimes the ears don't connect.
Right.
But a lot of times it comes down to that management team and to how it was marketed. And listen, Lawrence Gowan, Criminal Mind, should have been all over MTV. Canadian company said, no, we're going to sandbox you. And it's like, wow. So that's what happens sometimes. It really comes down to the team behind you, because I think fans like all kinds of music.
They do, and they don't know it. You know, if it's sometimes it's hiding in plain sight. I mean, I look at the British blues boom of the 60s, and they're doing Albert King covers coming over here to America. Cream is playing Madison Square Garden, and Albert King's playing the Fillmore with 10 other bands because
right.
Bill Graham's going, you got to check this guy out, you know.
Right.
But they're both playing Born Under a Bad Sign, you know.
Right.
So talk to me when you got to your first interview, from what I've read, was Gene Simmons.
Yes.
When you were 11 years old.
Correct.
How does the music lover in you go from, I love music, now I'm curious, now I want to ask artists about it? How did you make that leap?
Wow. Okay. That's an interesting one. And it, again, it goes back to my environment. Listen, we were in this place where nobody, no public transit, no businesses. There was two channels on TV, so I had a lot of time to stare at records, and I would stare at O'Coin Management, and I had this idea one time on the back, because in the old days, you'd phone up the operator, you know, 212-555, and I got the number, and I said, hey, would Kiss be available for an interview? I phoned up O'Coin Management.
Right.
And they said, yes. And I went, huh. I went, really? And they said, well, we'll set you up with Paul Stanley, blah, 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 blah. And before we had to go out to New York, because the whole idea of phoners really didn't exist.
Yeah.
They phoned back and they said, oh, unfortunately, Paul won't be available. Would you mind talking to Gene? And I was like, all right, why not? And you know, part of that inquiring mind comes from the environment. There was nothing here to do. There was no TV to stare at. So you had to go look at magazines. You had to go, you know, you had to go seek information.
Right.
And so that's where that curiosity came from. The fact that I've always been good at being a self-starter and getting out there, phoning that number, because all the other fans were sitting at home going, oh man, I'd love to meet Gene one day. How do I do it? And my brain went, I'll figure out how to do it.
Just call him.
Call him. Right. You know? And I know it's going to sound strange for an 11-year-old, but Kiss was on a downward spiral. And in that time, you know, nobody, the Dynasty tour was sort of it didn't really sell well. And I thought, wow, this is the perfect time. And it worked. They were essentially desperate for press. So we drove down with my mom, and she's like, well, I'm going to have to go in as the person doing the interview. And I had to write all her questions. And so right. that's where it came from. So where the inquiring mind comes from, really, without sounding bad, probably just boredom. There was just nothing else to do in Centerville, Quebec in 1979-80. There was nothing, you know? Stare raccoons.
A lot of people ask me, well, why did you practice so much when you were a kid? I'm like, let me tell you something. Growing up in Utica, New York, which is basically the same geography and topography as Southern Canada.
You're 4 hours from me.
4 hours. And basically, if you caught a cold summer, a cold, rainy summer, you weren't going out. It was 3-4 days a week. It was rainy. It was cold. It wasn't a great summer.
I've been there.
And the winter started in October and lasted until May. And it was cold and gray and depressing. And you would wake up and you go, I got to figure out a way to get out of here, you know? Yep. And no offense to my brethren in Utica. I'm very proud to be born and raised in Utica, New York. But first time I went to California when I was 11 years old, I said to myself, I want to be involved in this, not, you know. And that was that motivation. What do you think makes a good interview? When you're interviewing somebody, because, you know, sometimes, I mean, I've been guilty of this. If I'm tired and I have a phoner at 6:30 and I'm just not chatty, what do you think, as a journalist, what makes a good interview? Is it your job to, like, elicit some sort of, like, emotional response, controversy, or do you subscribe to, like, it's just the conversation and there's no gotcha questions or any of that kind of stuff?
Well, okay, so my philosophy on what makes a good interview really comes down to two things. First of all, you need to be researched.
Yeah.
You know, when you interview let's say I'm interviewing you, and I say, hey, Joe, you've got a great new album, tell me about it. And you go, okay, we're promoting something, great first question. Second question, what's your favorite ice cream flavor? And you're like, oh, really? And we've seen those kinds of interviews before.
I've been involved in those. I've had it where I put out 43 records.
Right.
And this is as of last 2 years. Somebody asked me, so is this your first album? I said, hang up the phone, go to Wikipedia, call me back. I'm not trying to be an asshole. Just Google me and then call me back. Anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So that to me is the fundamental. You have to be researched. You have to be able to connect to the artist and not just do the same old, because I look at sometimes at other interviews and I go, ah, okay, Joe talked about, like, we did an interview recently and it's like, Joe has talked about being a 12-year-old prodigy in every interview.
Right.
There's no point in me asking him about that, because if you're a Bonamassa fan and you're listening to this interview, which is probably why you're listening to the interview, you're like, ugh, this story again. So for me, it's to try to get something not controversial, but maybe out of the ordinary or different. Like, I just interviewed Klaus from the Scorpions. That's the one that's running today.
Yeah.
And we talked about working with Desmond Child in 2007 on the Humanity Hour 1 album. Nobody really talks about that with Klaus. And he was like, oh, wow, hey, somebody's talking about this album. Everybody's right. Like, tell me about Blackout. The other thing is I never write any questions down. Never. I have no questions written down. I know why we're on the phone. We're on the phone to plug your new album. We're on the phone to plug your new tour. We're on the phone to plug your whatever. So that's got to be the first one or two questions. Okay, tell me about the album. And after that, I listen and I hear something and I go, ah, Joe mentioned he uses whatever, this kind of guitar pick. And I have notes on the computer and I go, okay, well, let's go over here and let's go down that little rabbit hole. And then, you know, at some point, if the rabbit hole stops, I go, okay, well, tell me about working with so-and-so. Tell me about, and so the fundamentals are: be researched, don't be contrived, and listen. I mean, right. Listen, because there's a lot of times where the interview writes itself. You as Joe will give me an answer and I'll go, ah, that's five extra questions.
Right.
And that's what you got to do. And a lot of people, and I've seen them, I've been to press tents at Heavy Montreal or Oceag or any of these festivals. And you'll see somebody walk in and they'll be like, all right, so Joe, question one, tell me about the new album. Great. Okay, yes, stop talking. Question two. All right, tell me about the tour. And you're still talking and they're just going through and it's just like, oh my God, what are you doing? You've got an artist in front of you, a creative mind in front of you. Work with it. Listen to what he's saying. Build on what has been said. And so that to me is the fundamental of an interview.
What's your policy on, like, if the publicist... like when we booked our interview, we just texted each other. I'm like, yeah, I'll be there on Tuesday.
Yeah.
Right. What's your policy? Like, okay, you get a big name rock star.
Right.
Publicist goes to you, here's a list of stuff he doesn't want to talk or he or she doesn't want to talk about.
Yes.
And it's all the stuff you as a journalist go, hey, listen, this is fair game and this is what the fans are mm-hmm. gonna tune into this. What do you do? Do you go, I don't want to do the interview or I'll dance around it, or how do you handle that?
Wow, it's all of the above. First of all, there has to be a mutual respect. If somebody says to you, I don't want to talk about being drunk on the bus last week, you go, okay, because ultimately that publicist is the publicist for three or four other artists.
Right.
So you shoot yourself in the foot if you go, oh, I'm going to be a smart ass and just go. So you can't do that. But sometimes I've been told, don't ask about this. And I go, okay. And then the artist will bring it up and say, well, you know, that time I was on the bus and I was drunk. And you go, oh, right. And then I just go, well, he mentioned it.
Right.
What do you want me to do about it? So, yeah, I'll be prepared. And when that comes up, I will listen and I will go down that road. But you have to have a certain respect. If they say, please don't talk. There was a band the other day that said, please don't talk about our former lead singer.
I was going to mention them. Lineup changes must be on the top of the please don't mention
so
X's name. And it's like having an ex-girlfriend. You know, I don't want to talk about that.
So I did the interview and we didn't talk about the ex at all.
Right.
Okay. And we had a but the good thing about it is that we did a half hour interview and it ran all kinds of interesting conversations and interesting roads, and we went all down these rabbit holes, and it was great. So it worked.
Right.
But sometimes the artist will give you these one word answers and you're like, dude, I got half an hour to fill. So we're gonna get to that lead singer if you don't start talking.
Right, exactly. What's of all time, you don't have to mention names.
Yes, what's because I have to work with these people.
what's the hardest question you've ever had to ask somebody that you'd be remiss as a journalist if you didn't ask?
Oh, that's easy. That's anytime there's a death. Right. You know, when an art, you know, I was just forgetting, and I'll mention, I was talking to Liberty DeVito the other day, drummer from Billy Joel's band. And he wrote this new book. It's coming out later this month. And he talks about his brother dying of AIDS. It was in a whole chapter. And then he talks about Stagmeyer committing suicide. And they are very relevant chapters in his book. And he's made a big thing about writing about it. And you're sort of, it's almost disrespectful to not ask, like, oh, yeah, they passed away. Let's not talk. That's rude.
Right.
So you have to talk about it. But, you know, do you really want to talk to somebody about their brother dying of, like, even now I'm uncomfortable. Like, am I being disrespectful mentioning it to you? But there are these significant chapters in the book. So it's almost like, well, you can't just ignore it because he wrote a whole book about it. But it's so voyeuristic, and death to me is the one that really, because I never know. I really don't want to be disrespectful. And with death, that fine line is, over here you're respectful and you whoop, and now you're into that. It's rough.
It's difficult because you want to be respectful to your guest, and but you're also there to plug the book, and it's all fair game. You know, if it's in the book, you know.
And that's why I asked.
Yeah. You know, I think, you know, I just read I read the Stevie Ray Vaughan book that Alan Paul did, and my band is Reese Winans,
right?
And you know, I ask him because I'm a Stevie fan, and there are certain things for him that are off limits, even as long as I've known Reese. Where like, be like, dude, tell me about what was going on. You're like, well, there was these times we barely made it out alive, and then there's these times where he'll open up. Do you think having that kind of story makes an artist more interesting? Like, I never went through the drugs and the debauchery. I just had a one-sided kind of career where I just was like, hey, listen, I play guitar, people clap, it's a means to an end. I love it. I love my fans.
Off we go. Yeah.
I'm a nerd, and then I have a nice collection of suits. End of story. Interview's over in 7 minutes.
All right.
Do you find like artists that have been through the fire and the fury, you know, sometimes self-inflicted, sometimes right. not. Do you find a depth in those artists that are lacking in, like, say, bozos like me?
No, not at all, because first of all, sometimes those stories are very cliche.
Right.
Sometimes, especially with bands from the 70s and 80s, a lot of the mythical stories were actually contrived by publicists who went, boy, this would really sound good if we told the people that you were one of these guys.
Right.
But, you know, I don't do drugs. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I never have.
Right.
So those kind of stories of, you know, Motley Crue's girl, 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 go, they don't really interest me. And so as an interviewer, if I'm not interested in what I'm talking about, it makes for a bad interview. So I don't think it necessarily adds to the mystique. I think that I can interview Vince Neil or Joe Bonamassa the same way and end up with the same good story, because your path is very different. You know, to say, how does a guy go from Utica and just play guitar and just wear a nice suit, have worldwide success? Obviously, it has nothing to do with groupies. It has nothing to do with snorting ants off a pavement.
Right.
And so that's fascinating, because it's like, well, wait a minute. How can I, Mitch Lafon, learn from Joe's experience and up my game? So I find that fascinating. And, you know, listen, the Motley Crue stories or those kinds of stories, are they interesting? Are they compelling? They can be. But sometimes it's not that interesting, because those people were so wasted that you'll interview them and you'll say, tell me about 1987. They're like, I really don't remember it.
Right. It's kind of a blur.
I got nothing. Which is why when I read some of their books, I look at them and I go, are you sure you're remembering all of this? Or did somebody come out? You know, you read those Kiss books and you read the Peter Criss one and the Paul Stanley one and the Ace one, and they're all completely different stories. And you go, I think I'm going to trust him. He was the most sober, you know?
Right, exactly. You know, we live in a clickbait
right.
world now. And
oh, yeah.
I'll give you the clickbait for this interview. Like right. when it comes to drugs, I was telling my friend about 6 months ago, and she asked me, she's like, have you ever done like cocaine or any of that? I go, listen to me. I tried weed 5 times in my right. 20s. It made me hungry and paranoid, which I wake up in the morning hungry and paranoid to begin with. So I don't need it. And I said to her, and I was just kind of doing like a bit, like a comedy bit. I said, you know, in 31 years in the music business, nobody has ever offered me cocaine of any sort, to the point I'm offended. I'm like, I'm offended nobody's even offered, right? I know it's happening around me, but nobody's even offered. When you do interviews like that, right. like there's the clickbait. You know, I could just see I'm blabbermouth. Joe Bonamassa is offended and nobody's ever offered him cocaine. Total bullshit, because what they don't do is take the context of the bit. It's a comedy right. thing. Like, if you're talking to Vince Neil and they're like, oh God, and yeah, I think I don't even remember 1987, but I think somebody snorted ants off a skateboard. Boom. There's the clickbait.
Right.
And they usually use some sort of unflattering photo of the protagonist. And you know, 1987, I snorted ants off a skateboard. And they get people to click on these things, and it has nothing to do with the context. And then the inevitable pile. I've been a victim of that a few
right.
times. Sometimes self-inflicted, sometimes not. What do you think about that kind of journalism? Does it make you just go, man? Because you're one of the good ones, and it makes you just go, man, this is bullshit.
It irritates me. I'll tell you why it irritates me. First of all, because when you decontextualize something, it has no meaning anymore. It's right. just, you know, I, for the better or for the worst, will run an interview all the way through. Sometimes I sound like I've asked a bad question, and sometimes but I go, you know what? This is what the conversation was. Right. And you can listen to it and hear exactly what we said to each other, and you can find nuggets and... But the clickbaity stuff, and I'll give you an example, and we'll talk about Blabbermouth. They, a few years ago, took an interview I did with Lou Gramm.
Right.
And they took a couple of parts about from Lou, and at the bottom, they added a 2004 interview with Mick Jones calling Lou Gramm all kinds of nasty words.
Right.
And Lou Gramm's wife phoned me and goes, you're banned from all our shows forever. I go, for what? They go, you're on Blabbermouth. I go, I didn't write it. They right. wrote it. They go, yeah, but you did the interview, so you're responsible. I go, No.
Right. Right. Exactly.
And that drives me crazy. And the other thing that drives me crazy is, you know, on my socials, when I post an interview and stuff, and I get some really horrific comments sometimes of, yeah, well, he's a drug, blah, blah, blah. I'll clean them up. The ones I see, I will delete, and I will try to keep it as clean, because I'm here to promote the artist. They did me a favor. Right. And I'm not going to repay them by kicking them in the butt and going, oh, well, I didn't say Joe was a loser. This guy said it. No, I'm responsible.
Yeah, it just devolves into this pile on.
Right, and I do think that sites like Blabbermouth and all those other ones on their social medias, they should clean it up a bit, because ultimately they are promoting these bands, and if the bands decided, hey, you know what, tell my publicist I don't want to be on that site anymore, they'd be out of business. And so they should have a respect to the people that are actually giving them money, because they're monetizing your content.
And it's also too, I mean, like they have a responsibility. Like I know my friend Mike Portnoy, he cannot tie his own shoes without and say the words, I'm going to tie my own shoes, without it being on Blabbermouth.
Yeah. Him and John Karabi, just always.
In some sort of context of Dream Theater. You know what I mean? And I'm friends with all those guys, you know? And I just go, it's not that antagonistic, but it's like, it's almost like the professional wrestling of journalism. It's not fun until there's all out warfare on the comments. There's all out, you know. But what to me is unfair is what they don't really think it through in three dimensions is the fact that, you know, a guy like Mike Portnoy or John Karabi or any of these people, like whoever's the du jour, you know, artist of the day, you're making it a referendum on a lifetime's worth of work. You know, it's not like these guys just picked the thing up and decided I'm going to try this drumming thing out. Mike's been playing his whole life, you know, and it's very easy to marginalize, you know, and I find it just a bit strange that everything is online now, because you could just type anything and it goes viral. Do you miss the magazines? Do you miss the print?
I do miss the magazines. Let me just finish on Portnoy for a second. You know, I did a master's in psychology. And so in psychology, there's this theory that every 10 years you become a new person.
Right.
And I'll give you a quick thing. You know, the 5-year-old you and the 15-year-old you are obviously not the same.
Right.
And if the 25-year-old you met the 15-year-old you, you'd be like, oh, you had that haircut? You know, because we all look back and go, I wore those pants to high school. Oh, geez. Right. And the 35 to the. And so the problem sometimes with artists is that we don't, as media, allow them to have these rebirths. So Mike Portnoy is the guy from Dream Theater, 1997, period. That's it. And it's like, no, Mike, like you and like me, looks back at those pictures and go, oh, I was wearing my hair like that. Oh, my God. And we should allow for that. We should allow for the fact that people every 10 years become a new person. And I think that's a fabulous psychological theory. I mean, I really ascribe to it.
Exactly. Because everybody grows, you know, and not many people know that he's a great singer. He's a great songwriter. He's a great all around musician, because that doesn't sell clicks. We're not selling copies now. We're selling clicks.
Yes. Now, as far as the magazines, let me just cut you off for that. Do I miss the magazines? Yes and no. And I'll tell you why. Yes, back in the day, it was nice to sit down, because, like, again, there was nothing going on here. So to pull out something and have a little pinup poster of Kiss and then stick it with some sticky tack on the wall.
Yeah.
Fabulous. But listen, you look at Hit Parader, they didn't really have any writers. It was all cut and paste of publicist press releases.
Yeah.
If you really look at it, they just took press releases and they reprinted them. The information was always 3, 4, 5 months old.
Right.
And it'll be like, oh, you know, Joe Bonamassa is releasing an album in July. And you get the magazine, and then for whatever reason it's delayed. And now you're reading it in September going, hey, he should have put out an album 2 months ago. What happened?
Right.
And so there was no way to be current with what the band or the fan or whatever was doing. These days, I like the instant access that you can get from sites. You know, if I have to research something, it's right there and I can find out all kinds of stuff. And he said this. But sometimes also it's not accurate. I read. Listen, I read something. I put out a Kiss tribute album in 2013 on my birthday, which also happened to be my wife's father's birthday, who had died of cancer, and it was a whole thing. And I read online, it came out like, you know, in October, and I'm like, well, no.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah,
I know that's wrong, and so sometimes the information is just thrown up so slapstick.
Right.
That it's completely inaccurate. It's completely decontextualized, and there are too many. You know, it's nice. You go to Ultimate Classic Rock, you go to Blabbermouth, it's there, it's fine. But then there's all these tertiary ones, and it's just, at some point, it gets so whittled down, and the information, and they all try to have their own little shtick. I'm going to be the guy that calls people out. I'm going to be the guy that says Joe can't do this. I'm going to be the really nice. And at some point, it's like, you know what? It was so much easier just to buy cream.
Exactly. I think the volume of content, because, right. You know, like now that everybody for the last 4 months has basically been housebound and, you know, antisocial, like I've been practicing for 25 years. You see online that they're actually selling podcast kits.
Right.
Meaning you get the microphone, you get the little preamp, you get the everyone, including this carpetbagger, is a broadcaster now. Because we're all trying to pivot and find different ways to stay current. What do you think about that? Like, I think it's just the amount of content is so vast that it dilutes the real stuff. Because it's like,
I used to
be able to buy 5 magazines, Guitar World, Guitar Player, yeah. Rolling Stone, Cream, these were real journalists, and that like it was vetted content, and it was, whether you agree with it or not, it felt pro to me. Now,
yes. Oh, absolutely.
Like, now everybody's a broadcaster, and everybody's got a podcast, and everybody's. But you're one of the people that have been in it for 20 years. I mean, what do you just roll your eyes and go, here comes another one. Here comes another one. You know, do you change anything about what you're doing to react to the amount of content, or do you just go, I've been Mitch Lafon for 20 years, and I'm going to keep doing it?
Yeah, you know what? Ultimately, I always feel that content is king. That to me. So my last few interviews have been Coverdale, have been Klaus Meine, have been Dennis DeYoung, have been Liberty DeVito. So I've made a very conscious effort in these pandemic times to go get A-listers.
Right.
Because, you know, normally every so often you have to go talk to whatever. And I don't mean to insult anybody, but you have to talk to a Faster Pussycat or an LA Guns because, you know, you need to add flavor to what you're doing. But now I see everybody's doing that. Everybody's interviewing everybody. So you go, okay, you know what? We got to back away from maybe some of the B and C and D bands and stick to those because I have to rise above. But that's complicated. Because right. Not every A band is available every week. So that's what I know that might sound bad, and I probably insulted some of the B and C list bands. No offense meant, but you know, you have to.
I'll tell you my Paul Stanley story about like I've never been I'm at best on my best day a D or E list celebrity. Okay, that's on my best day.
And I disagree.
I remember in 2008, I'm in the Middle East, and I'm doing this corporate gig out there, and I get a call from Doc McGee's office going, hey, please hold for Paul Stanley. I'm like, what is this? I never talked to him. He calls me up, and he goes, listen, my son Evan plays guitar, and his two favorite guitar players are Eric Clapton and yourself. And he goes, no offense, but I figured it'd be a lot easier to get you on the phone than Eric Clapton. I said, Paul, no offense taken. I get it. I'm easy.
Evan's a great player, by the way.
He's a great player, and I love Paul. And like we've been friends ever since then. And it's like he's like, you know, one of my, you know, best buds. I'm gonna talk to you about maybe a controversial subject. Maybe you don't want to talk about it, but I think it's relevant in a journalistic context.
Right.
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Yes. Yes.
Who's in and who's out? Now, I'll preface this. This is not a referendum on who's in. Everybody's deserving of the statue. I know two of my friends have the statue, Reese and Glenn Hughes. Couldn't be happier.
Right.
What took them so long? I have no idea.
Right.
But there are, when you're talking about the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I just jotted down some, just some names that people may have heard of that are not in. Judas Priest, Thin Lizzy, Todd Rundgren, Warren Zevon, Iron Maiden, Tina Turner as a solo artist, Free, Bad Company, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, and Jethro Tull.
Can I give you my first reaction? My first
just
reaction?
Give me your first reaction of like, does being in the Hall of Fame mean anything, or is it is there such a
ultimately it means nothing. Right. You know, whether, you know, the guys from Tesla ever get into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, does it really mean that Tesla's music is invalid? No. No. But my first reaction when that comes up, and obviously you talked about Iron Maiden and Thin Lizzy, but I always go straight to Foreigner. They dominated 77 to 86 about.
Yes.
First five albums were top five albums on Billboard's 200 album chart. First five, first one, the sophomore, and I've looked it up. I don't think any other band has had their first five albums be top five.
Right.
You go to any, you know, movie or commercial and you'll hear Hot Blooded and any classic, you'll drive in any state, whether it's Mississippi, Missouri, or Montreal, Canada, you will hear one of those songs. They have changed the way that pop song, that pop rock song was written.
Right.
And they're never even mentioned. And you're like, wow. And you look at Iron Maiden. You mentioned Iron Maiden. They took, I guess, from what was going on with Sabbath and stuff, but then they turned it into their own thing in terms of marketing, in terms of imagery, in terms of mascots, in terms of planes. This, everybody wants to be them. And I think if everybody wants to be you, that makes you be one wanna. That makes you a Rock and Roll Hall of Famer. You know, everybody wants to be Babe Ruth.
Right.
And I think that's one of the ways you have to sort of look at it. If every single fan desires to be that guy, it's probably because they've influenced you around.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and I know a lot of I know a lot of people that are in Hall of Fame bands.
By the way, Huey Lewis needs to go in.
Huey Lewis. So imagine. Putting together a festival, a rock and roll festival of the ones that are not in. You could put Bad Company in there. You could put Pat Benatar. You could put Thin Lizzy. You could put Foreigner and Huey Lewis. You start the show. You can it doesn't matter who headlines. You can start the show at 3 o'clock and you can run it till midnight. And all you ask the bands to do is play their hits. They could literally play 9 hours of life changing music.
Yes.
And you go. Of life-changing rock and roll. And you go, where's the disconnect in Cleveland that to me, what my biggest fear is what happened to a friend of mine who was a bass player in a very influential prog band. Right. I knew him for years. I loved the man. And I had conversations with him. He's like, you know, it's like we've been doing this since the 1970 and we've made some huge albums. We played stadiums. And I'm like, Chris, your music has changed my life. And my father's life, and he's like, man, just before I die, I'd love to just be acknowledged by the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for our contributions in the music. And I know a lot of people feel that way,
right?
And I know some people just say, ah, fuck them, you know, whatever. I don't care if I get in, but there's always a side that it's just the validation of a life's work,
right?
But
even the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has a disconnect. You look at the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Right.
And every single person who touched a guitar or an instrument is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And then you look at Black Sabbath and they go, oh, no, Ronnie James Dio doesn't count. And you go, of course he counts.
Of course he counts, right.
And then you look at Kiss, they go, Eric Carr doesn't count. You go, yes, he does. How does Josh whatever from Red Hot get in and Ronnie James Dio? And you're like, okay, I don't understand now. I don't get what you're doing. Like,
I thought Tommy Bolin should have went in with Deep Purple.
Yes.
I thought Tommy Bolin should have went in just as a member of Deep Purple. There's the first four, you know, iterations of the band. And you know, until they basically had to do a hard stop and then reboot with Joe Lynn Turner and, you know, and so at the end of the, you know, it's like, and I know it meant something to Tommy's brother, you know, cause I've gotten to know his family. You know, it's one of the things. Why is rock and roll, and I get this with the blues, why is rock and roll so polarizing as a medium, as a genre of music where it's just debated to the point of it pits friend against friend, and sometimes, you know, it's a very hot button issue. You know, people right. love the music, and they go, this band deserves to be in, and that band doesn't. You know, it's like, and there's a lot of what do you think about the music makes it that that incendiary?
That's real simple. It comes down to passion. Right. We are passionate about what we love. So if you love Iron Maiden and you've worn the leather, you know, the denim jacket with the patch, and that's your band. And for me to come along and go, Judas Priest is better, I'm invalidating your entire existence. I'm just saying you don't, you know, what you love doesn't exist. And so my passion goes, oh, no. I love Maiden. They are the best. And so that's it. It's just that passion. It right. really comes down to that. When you tell a Kiss fan that Kiss sucks, they go, what? Because it means your last 40 years have sucked. It means everything you've done for the last 20 years, 40 years of loving them, playing them in the car, top down, that all sucks. And you go, no. And so yeah. we all feel that way. And whether you like Bjork or whether you like the Kinks or whether you like Madonna, they are a person. They are part of you, of your personality. You grow up a Madonna fan. You wore the fishnet. You did the hair. And so bands and rock bands are an extension of you. And so when I say that band, I say Joe Bonamassa sucks, you go, hey, wait a minute. But no, that's me. I don't. And so that's why. Because it devalues the person. Because right. you know,
it's an affront and a referendum on their not only their taste but their
life, their being.
Life. Yes. And their band. It's like a lot of people have tattoos of
yes.
You know, and it's a right. permanent so, thing.
Try to tell a guy with a Gene Simmons tattoo that Kiss sucks. You can't, because it meant so much to him that he memorialized it on his being.
Right.
And now you're saying that is invalid, and you go, no, it's not. And so we all do that. And that's why we will have these discussions ad nauseum. Guns N' Roses this, Metallica that, Foreigner this, Pat Benatar that. And that's why when you say the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, you know, look, I look at Patti Smyth who got in and I go, I don't get it. But you know what? She deserves to be there, because for somebody somewhere in New York City at CBGB's or Max's Kansas City or wherever she played, she affected their life and changed it.
Absolutely. Everybody who's in affected someone's life in a life-changing way. It's like I said, I always say it's not a referendum on who's in. It's there's a point where right. you know the point is you can only, these are some of the seminal bands of rock and roll in the mid right. 70s to mid 80s have been shut out of this conversation. But if you listen to KLOS or any classic rock radio, chances are the bulk of the playlist is going to be from Foreigner 4, Bad Company. Mm-hmm. You know, you're going to hear Thick as a Brick from Jethro Tull. You're going to hear, you know, you're going to hear it all.
You're going to hear it all. And, right. you know, to look at what goes into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, what you really need to do is go back to the back issues of Rolling Stone from the 80s. And you go, hey, I'm not seeing a lot of Pat Benatar in this issue. Listen, it is a political game. They covered a whole bunch of people in the 80s and 90s. They didn't cover, you know, and they left Foreigner out. They let Pat Benatar out. And for some reason, they're still holding a whatever. They got their panties in a bunch over it, going, I'm not letting Mick Jones in.
Okay.
All right. Don't let Mick Jones in, you know. The guy produced Stormfront. The guy produced 5150. The guy's been on all these things. I'm forgetting the name of the band he was in before Foreigner. What was he in before Foreigner?
It wasn't Procol Harum or.
No. All right. Luckily, I have my computer. So, right. so keep talking, and I will quickly look.
All right. Before we wrap up, I have a question. As a journalist, I'm interested in your take on it.
Yes.
Live versus live with tracks.
Ooh. Oh, by the way, he was in Spooky Tooth. There we go.
Okay, that's right. Spooky Tooth. Robin Trower's in Proclaim.
Yes.
You go to see a live show.
Yes.
You want to see four dudes up there, warts and all? Or do you want to hear it like the record with the Pro Tools rig augmenting it?
Boy.
What's your take on that?
That is a tough one. And I'm going to go all over the place with this one. When I go to a smaller club, a theater, 1,000 feet, I want the blood, sweat, and tears of that band on the floor. My co-host, Alan Niven, always says there's a perfection in the imperfection.
Right.
And so I like if there's a bum note, if there's feedback, because you go, I got a live show.
Yeah.
That said, when you go to an arena and you've just put down $350 or $200 to go see whoever, whether it's Post Malone or Madonna or Kiss on the reunion tour, and they come out and it sucks. You just go, wow, I just spent $350 for me and the wife, plus the dinner, plus the drive-in. I've now spent $800 to get to this thing, and it was horrible.
Right.
And I see it from the artist's perspective. First of all, you have to be perfect every time.
Right.
Because that's what fans expect.
And but, and instead of lighters, they're holding this thing
right.
with the video on and right. for the whole show.
But that's it. Social media has changed everything, because if I'm sitting here going, do I go see Joe in Montreal for 150? I really like his albums, but, and then I start seeing on Twitter, he sucked in Cincinnati. He was awful. I go, yeah, maybe I'm not going to spend that cash. Maybe I'm just going to go see Judas Priest next week. So I can understand why an artist wants to be perfect, because if they're not, social media will devastate them. And if they devastate them, it could actually tank a tour. I mean, it can actually go to that yeah. level. And there are other artists where the song is just a vehicle for the performance. You go see Gwen Stefani, you go see Madonna, you go see Shania Twain, you go see those ones. You're not really there for the songs. You're there for the hang and the lasers and the dancing.
Right.
And so you can't expect Madonna to do 2 hours of dancing and trapeze like Pink does,
yes.
and then be on key. So there's a give and take depending who you go see. But if I'm in a tiny bar, there's 100 people, and you roll up and plug in, and then there's a machine playing, it's like, dude, no. We're not doing that. But in the arena shows, unfortunately...
Yeah, I mean, I remember being at a rehearsal facility in North Hollywood where I had my storage locker, and I was just going in to get a guitar or something. And I heard a band coming out of Studio C, and I was like, oh, yeah, I remember these guys, and they won a singing contest. I'm like, I remember these guys. That's cool. And I'm sitting outside the door, and I'm like, going, wow, they're killing it. Singers, like, really killing it. And I'm like, boy, it's good to see a young band rehearsing hard and giving it their all. Even when they don't have to, because I hate to rehearse. And I'm like, all right, let's just run through the form.
Right.
And anyway, the door swings open. There's only one musician on the deck. He's playing bass. And the rest of it's coming through this, like, PA they set up. And I'm like... how does that work? And then I go, oh my God. And then there's a guy with a computer and a bunch of tracks. And I'm like, I go, wow. And here I am and singing and playing guitar all these years like a sucker. I can get away with this. This is great.
Get away with this. I'll tell you, there's two instances from my concert going experience, which I'll never forget. I was at a festival, the Oceaga Festival in Montreal. And I got to sound check early. And I will never forget these words. Somebody went, I need more computer in the monitor. And I was like, you need more computer? What? And the other one, and I'm not going to say the band, but I was at a 80s arena act
right.
concert. And I was at sound check at 2:00 in the afternoon. And they were actually sound checking Crowdswell. And I'm like,
oh, wow.
I'm like, Crowdswell. And people are like, what? The clapping. They were probably... They're like, okay, so at this song, and they were practicing the Crowdswell. And I was like, my God, are you kidding me? Not yeah. only are they going to be lip syncing tonight, but the audience reaction is going to be piped. And it blew me away. And this was 2018, 2007. I mean, this is not 15 years ago.
No. Wow.
And it was a big arena act, big tour. And they were sound checking Crowdswell, and I went, Okay, that's a whole new level of no.
I've been trying to get my light guy to buy some of those old applause signs from the old sitcoms. Just light them up, you know. I did a good solo. I could just step on a button, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. Mitch, thank you for doing this, man. You're one of my favorite journalists, and I always love having a conversation with a journalist, because I think in a different life I would be one, because I'm always curious about it, and a good journalist is passionate about what they believe and stick the landing, and you're a good egg, man. Thanks for doing this. Ladies and gentlemen, the wonderful Mitch Lafon, host of Rock Talk with Mitch Lafon. And by the way, happy Canada Day to all you Canadians out there.
Even brought my Tim Hortons cup for that.
That's right. If what's a Tim Hortons? I go, just go to Canada. So I'm not going to even explain it to you.
You'll understand.
You'll understand as soon as you cross the border. There's a Tim Hortons. It's like a maple leaf welcoming you, and a Tim Hortons on the right.
We're actually thinking of making our customs Tim Hortons. So as you drive through and go, yeah, I'm just going to Montreal, they'll give you a coffee at the same time. It's a new concept.
Coffee and a donut. I love it.
donut and get in.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for watching, ladies and gentlemen. This will be on YouTube in perpetuity, so you can watch it anytime. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Joe Bonamassa, and you're watching Live from Nerdville. See, look, notice the hat.
Ooh, I'm going to need to get one of those.
I'll send you one.
Thank you.
And we're good.